And one of the things that whenever we went to these places, especially Yellowstone, there would be signs that would say, no camping allowed. And there was reasons. And most of the time, the campsites that said, no camping allowed, were some of the nicest sites. Or they were on a cliff, or they were overlooking the canyon. When, as children, we'd say, well, why can't we camp there? Well, I guess if a park ranger didn't stop you, you could. But usually, there was small print on the no camping allowed sign that might have said bears, might have said rock slides, might have said cliffs, might have said this valley tends to flood if the river overflows. There was reasons why you didn't camp in places you weren't allowed. And if you tried to camp in those sites, could be danger, could be the end of your life, could be a lot of things. And I started thinking, we do that as people. We choose, now the Bible does not mention the word camp as far as going camping, but it does mention set your tent, place your tent, choose to stay here, choose to abide here, choose to set your camp up here. And he's got a lot of advice God does all throughout the Old Testament especially. And you'll see it a lot in Psalms. But I found a passage in Genesis, which I love, and I'm going to read it. Genesis 13, it was about Abram, who later became Abraham, and his nephew Lot. So Abraham, chapter 13, left Egypt, traveled north into the Negev, along with his wife and Lot, and all that they owned. Abram was very rich in livestock, silver, and gold. So they continued by stages toward Bethel, and they pitched their tents between Bethel and Ai, where they had camped before. And this was the same place, if you've read the Old Testament, that Abram had built an altar there, and he worshiped the Lord again. In the old days, whenever something really good happened, or God performed a mighty act, they made an altar. They made a little pile of stones so that every time they went back to that area, they'd say, wow, look what God has done. So they were in the same place. But now Abram and his nephew, finally there started to be conflict because they were both camped in the same place. They both set up their tents in the same place. And the herdsmen started arguing, their livestock were eating the same ground, and people started fighting, as happens when you really camp if you're too close to each other. You know, we had a family of five jammed in a teeny little tent. My husband said, did you all sleep in there? And I said, oh yeah, five sleeping bags, and it was a small tent. My dad would be digging trenches around it every night, and not necessarily fun, but perfect for an example if you're going to speak or teach. So Abram says to Lot, we're going to separate. You go to the right, and I'll go to the left. Or, he was very benevolent, if you want to go left, then I'll go right and settle. You pick the land where you want to pitch your tent, and you want to camp. So, Lot said, I'll go this way. He looked at the land, and he saw that it was fertile plains in the Jordan Valley. It was in the direction of Zoar. It was well-watered. It looked like the Garden of Eden. Lot chose this for himself, and he went with his servants, and off he goes. Now, I always liked the fact that Lot was the nephew, and he never once said to Abram, you're the uncle, you're older than me, you choose first. But he didn't. He said, oh, that looks good, I'm going over there. Lot moved his tents near a place called Sodom and settled amongst the cities. Now, had Lot been smart, and he asked God, should I settle here? There probably was a no camping sign. Think about it. You say God doesn't say no camping? Sure he does. Because had Lot gone over and read the sign, it might have said, people who move to this city get turned to pillars of salt. But no, he didn't read that sign. He thought, this looks great. I want to be near the city. Good old Uncle Abraham is going that way. So that's where he settled. After Lot had left, the Lord said to Abram in verse 14, look as far as you can see in every direction, north, south, east, west. I'm going to give all this land to you. As far as you can see, you and your descendants will have it. Go walk the land in every direction, I'm giving it to you. So Abram moved his camp towards Hebron, and there he settled and built another altar to the Lord. Now, the minute Lot moved in to Sodom, it said the people there were very evil and did not worship the Lord, did not listen. They were not godly people. What do you call that? I call that no camping allowed here. So God does show signs. No camping allowed here. That should have been the first sign he saw. The people were evil and they did not worship God. Well, no camping allowed. Now, what do we do in our normal life? That's the question I start thinking. No camping allowed. Like, where do we camp nowadays? Are you setting up camp? If you're here today, because I kept thinking, I certainly have set up camp in places that I should not have been. And once I got positioned there, sometimes I was smart enough, unlike Lot, I'd see the sign that God says, oh, read the small print, Lisa, it's in my word. You don't need to be here. Leave here. Leave these people. Move on. Other times, I've gotten myself positioned in my little tent and stayed in areas I shouldn't have been and wondered, why isn't God getting me out of here? Why is everything going wrong? When God clearly was showing signs that said, no camping allowed. Now you might be thinking, I've never seen a no camping allowed sign. Sure you have. If you've ever opened the Bible and you're feeling a little convicted, it's something that you shouldn't be doing or saying or in a place you should be residing, I'm going to let you throw it out. What are some areas that could be no camping sites for us? Think about it. How about anger? Who's camping in anger? Somebody here today, I guarantee you, is angry, and they deserve to be angry. Somebody did you wrong, and you've set your tent on that story. You're making sure everybody knows why you're angry, and you're choosing to live here, to camp here. And yet the sign is saying no camping. How do I know that? Because God's word talks about not staying angry. If God's word mentions don't stay angry, don't let the sun go down on your anger, then how in the world could you have erected a tent? If the sun goes, you don't need the tent till after the sun goes down. Now, but I deserve to be angry. You probably do. But if you camp there and stay there, it's going to turn into bitterness. You're going to bring down all other kinds of things in your life. Now, but if I went over and I said, oh, there's small print on this no camping sign. What? Why can't I camp here in anger, God? And he says, oh, look at the small print. I didn't read this. Anger. God was talking to Cain in the Garden of Eden. He said, why are you so angry? Why is your face so dark with rage? It can be bright with joy if you do what you should. But if you refuse to obey and get rid of your anger, watch out. Sin is waiting to attack you. It's longing to destroy you. It's crouching at your door, but you can conquer it. I like that small print. Don't you? Right about now, when you read that, is where we should be saying, pull up the stakes, put out the campfire, pack the tent, let's get out of anger. But we don't. We stay there. And we hold on to our anger. And even when we're about to let our anger go, do you ever notice this about yourself? Sometimes we relive the story in our mind and then we're angry all over again. You don't know what they did. I don't know. But I know what people have done to me. And if I chose to stay angry, it's not a good place. God says you can have all kinds of joy. No camping allowed. Pull up the stakes right now. Where else would you camp? I mean, I got a ton of them. Fear, worry, what else? Health, scared of the future, scared of the end times. Now I am being facetious, but we do get camping on the end times. We don't know if this is the end times or not. The disciples thought it the end times. My grandmother thought it was the end times. My great-grandmother thought it was the end times. So if you get camped in fear and worry about what's going to happen in the future, you've now resigned yourself to just living in this one spot. You've camped on your worry and your fear. Doesn't the Bible talk about no worry and no fear? Do not be anxious. Instead, what? Pray. Because he knows you're going to be anxious. So pray about everything with prayer and petition, prayer and thanksgiving. Did you ever try staying in an angry or worried tent and being thankful to God? Thank you for this wonderful life, Lord. You've given me so much. It makes me want to get out of the tent. You can't sit here and praise the Lord. What's another fake place you might camp? How about grumbling and complaining? That one kills me. Grumbling and complaining. Okay, once grumbling and complaining. But I know people that actually are proud to tell you, everybody knows me, I'm the grumbler and complainer at work. Who would say that? Grumbling and complaining. Yep, that's me. That's just how I am. I always see the bad. Somebody said to me recently, and I do not make this up, you know me, I always see the worst, so I kind of complain and I get scared and I'm worried and I'm thinking, pull up the stakes of that tent. Don't wear it as a badge. Do you grumble and complain about your job, about your spouse, about your friends, about your church, about your choir, about the choir director, about your kids, about the school, about your kid's teacher? You are a grumbler and complainer from way back, and everybody knows it. How about pulling the stakes up on that campground and moving out? God has some very clear directions. Well, I didn't really see the sign, God, about grumbling and complaining. Oh, you didn't? Well, put those readers on. Let's look. Philippians. Oh, the small print talks about grumbling and complaining. You're telling me God doesn't give signs that say no camping? Sure he does. Philippians 2:14. Do all things without grumbling and complaining. This is the Bible. But God never puts no camping signs in front of me. Do all things without grumbling and complaining, so that no one can speak a word of blame against you. You are to live a clean, innocent life as a child of God in a dark world full of crooked and perverse people. You are supposed to shine out among them like a beacon of light or a shining star. That is a no camping sign for grumbling and complaining. Can't get any clearer than that. You cannot say, well, I was just born this way. My mom complained, my grandma complained, we all complained. Well, you know what? I guarantee your tent is not going to have many others in it with you. For real. You won't have many others around you, and then you'll wonder, I wonder why. No camping allowed here. That's what I hear God saying. No setting your tent and staying. You know, there's gossip, slander, lies. I've been lying my whole life. I don't even know what the truth is anymore. Yeah, well, God knows what the truth is. And it's always the first day to start telling the truth. What does the Bible say about truth? I don't even have to go look at the sign. The truth will set you free. It might be hard if you've had a history of lying, but if you've got to tell the truth now, pull up those stakes and leave that campground. What about no grace or mercy for people? I really understand God's grace and mercy. I know it. I sing every week, grace, grace, God's grace, grace. That is, I sing all those songs. I know the verses. I can quote them. It was by grace I've been saved, not of my own works. Sure, you know it, but how are you treating other people that aren't quite there yet? I'm in my little tent of piety because how dare they do that? Don't they get it? Or have you seen her? Or what in the world are they doing that for? Maybe you don't say it, but you're thinking it. And if you are, then you're camping on legalism, or you're camping on criticism, you're camping on, I don't like to use the word judgment, because there are times we need to make judgments on people, but you're camping on the fact that God's mercy was for you and his grace was for you, but maybe not yet for them. Then you don't get it. You don't get it. God's saying, no camping allowed here. You get how much I love you. I can't get over it myself. Julia, you said you've been a believer. She goes, I'm 36 now, and I've been a believer since 7. That's a long time. Well, I've been a believer since I was 6, and I'm 56 now. That's really long. And Althea, who in a week is going to be 98, has been a believer even much longer than that. How long you've been a believer should change you. It's not a number. I am still so amazed that God looks at me through that beautiful lens of Jesus Christ and says, that's my girl down there. I want the best for her. If she's stuck in a campsite, I can help get her out. He loves me, so I should look at other people that way. Read the small print, Lisa. Oh, there's something about grace. Hebrews 4:16, let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. And 1 John goes on to say, dear children, don't just love each other with words and tongue. Love each other with deeds and action. So are you camping in that spot where you accept God's grace and you're not giving it to others? Then I don't think so. You don't get it. Pull up those stakes, kick the fire out, and say, I gotta move out of this position. I've camped in the wrong spot. No camping allowed. That's another sign. Don't you see it in the Bible? I did. I just read it in Hebrews. How clear can God get? Yet we're saying, I didn't know I shouldn't camp here. I had no idea there was going to be bears and water slides and rock slides. Well, did you read the sign? This is my son. This is my son. If there's any question about setting my tent up in the wrong spot, it's here. It's right here. All you got to do is look. How about guilt, unforgiveness, guilt I love? Who's camping today? I guarantee you there's somebody here because I've camped there too. And doesn't matter whether you're young or old, you've decided I am guilty. I have guilt. You don't understand, Lisa. I have such guilt over the things I've done, or the way I've acted, or that I'm not good enough for God. You don't know what I do in secret. No, I don't. You don't know what I do in secret. But God does. And he looks at you right through that lens of Jesus and says, I see you. You need to let go of that guilt, because all that's doing is keeping you huddled in the wrong campground. You're staying here, and I need to use you. He needs to use us to spread the news to a few other friends who maybe are guilty. And we could come alongside them and go, guess what? You're camping in the wrong spot. They may look at you and go, what in the world are you talking about? And you're going to say, you've parked your RV in the guilt zone. And God's saying, you don't need to stay there. No camping allowed. How do you know, Lisa? Well, read the sign. Oh, yeah. I love this one. I should have read this one earlier before I even got here. Romans 8:1. There is therefore now no condemnation. You know what condemnation is? That means God looks at you and says, you're condemned to die. You're a sinner. You're a rat. You're an addict. You cheated on your spouse. You stole. You're a liar. You don't forgive. You don't do any of those things. And yet God is saying, don't camp there, because I'm telling you the total opposite. There is no condemnation from me. There is therefore no condemnation, Romans 8:1, for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit has set me free. And Psalm 103, oh, I love this verse. 103:12. As far as the east is from the west, God has taken our sin away for those who are in Christ Jesus. Do you know how far that is? The ocean is right over there. That's the east. All the way to California. And that's just a picture story. Boy, I get pumped up when I think of this.
Amen.
Why are you camped in a guilt zone when God's taking it away and he's saying, Lisa, read the fine print. Don't camp there. You're no use to anybody. You're not useful to anybody. You're putting the guilt on you. And if you have people around you that are making you feel guilty, still, walk away. No one says you have to stay at that campground with all those same people. This really got to me. As you can tell, this is really important to me that we don't stay in a place that God's never asked us to stay. And then we wonder, and the longer you stay there, some of you may have been camped in a spot that you're not allowed to camp in for 20, 30, 40, 50 years, maybe more. Some of you maybe have only been there a couple of years. Can I tell you right now, and I was debating on whether to mention this, but this week in my Bible study, I had a young girl who's 24, and it actually chokes me up to think about it. 24 years old, we thought for 2 years has been clean off of heroin. And she was. She was. She chose to go back to the campsite and was left on a bench in front of Paul Kimball Hospital and died on Friday night. 24 years old. 24. When you pick up camp, and that's the second point, are you camping in the wrong spot? Second point is pull up the stakes. You don't do it yourself. If you're thinking, I've been camping so long, I have been in this spot for so long, how do I pull up the stakes? And God's saying, you just have to let go. The stakes are buried in the ground. Do you ever remember back in the old days, you had to put, anybody who camped, your father went around and hooked everything and banged it in. And now the thing, you press a button and the tent opens up. But, you know, you had to hook it in and stretch it. Because God has given us a free will, he does not move our campsite for us. He can help us move it, but if you are gripping the ground like this, those stakes are in the ground so tight on something, he can't move your tent, or he won't move your tent. He's saying, I'll do the moving. You just pull up the stakes. Let loose. Be willing to pick up. I know it's hard, but I'll be with you. I know it's difficult. I've been doing this so long, Lord. I've been sitting in guilt. I've been angry. I've been selfish for so long. How am I going to get off this campsite? And he's saying, you don't worry about that. You don't worry about that. You just let go of the ground and I can move you. You have to have a willing heart that says, Lord, move me along. A thought that came to me when I was studying this, and I thought, what we do many times, and this is what this young girl did. What she did was she moved her campsite away from heroin. But she left the tent, and she left her stuff, and she left it comfortable just in case she might want to return. Now, we don't know we're doing that, but very often, do you notice that? Well, we'll leave it, Lord. When God says leave it, that tent goes down, you kick the fire out, you get all your junk out of it, and you leave the site. You don't walk away, and we don't know this sometimes. I believe she walked away and left the tent in case maybe we want to go back. Maybe I'll need it for a vacation home. Maybe I'll need to visit it. We can't do that. When God says move, you break it down and you move. You don't leave your stuff there. You don't go back. She went back and visited it, and she couldn't get back out. She was a believer. That I can praise God for. And I believe God might have thought maybe she couldn't make it in this world. That's how I reconcile it in my mind. But she also was a perfect example to me of never go back. Oh, the Bible says that? There's a no camping sign for never going back? Certainly. Philippians 3:13. Brothers, ladies, sisters, one thing I do, I forget what is behind and I strain toward what is ahead, pressing on to the goal. You have to learn to trade your trying. That's what I've had to do. I'll put it on me. Trade your trying for trust in God. When I don't get what's going on, Saturday I was crawling around my vegetable garden, and I told people this in my Bible study, crawling around my vegetable garden, and as I was digging, I'm like, Lord, what is going on? And I think in my mind, I clearly heard him say, I know. Well, what a perfect answer. You don't. And I'm like, but I don't. He basically said, but you don't need to know. What am I going to do about this? Why did this happen? I've got a plan, Lisa. You don't need to know it. What do you mean I don't need to know the plan? You don't need to know the plan. It comes down to trust. And as I kept digging and I had a little bit of a tear in my eye, I thought, and Lord, I do trust you. I do trust you. So whatever happens, you're going to help me get through it. I've just got to let go of the ground. One thing to add, if you know someone who is, maybe you're in a good camping spot. Now, I'm out of the bum tent right now. I could go back. But I'm out of the position, and I see a few friends still camping in bad areas. Look at them over there. They're in the rock slide territory. I can't wait to see what happens tonight. Look at them over there. They're going to be in big trouble. They shouldn't be camping. We sometimes do that. If you're in a good spot, now you don't do it gloatingly. Do you ever notice once somebody has a little bit of a victory in their own life, they want to give, like, lessons to everybody else. No, it's not about you telling them how to camp. It's about you coming alongside and being transparent and going, let me tell you what God did for me when I was in this spot. Let me tell you how I struggle. That's being transparent. And that's difficult, but that's what God's asking you to do. Not give them lessons and say, hey, maybe a rock slide's going to come. Why don't you come over to me? And stay in my tent a little bit, and I'll help you. I'll guide you. That's discipleship. That's coming alongside someone and getting them out. So, what does the Bible say about no camping? A lot. The end of the story of Lot, later in chapter 18, if you decide to read Genesis, God was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, and what amazes me is good old Abram, who let Lot go to Sodom, says to God, you've heard the story. If you find 100 men, don't destroy it. If you find 50, if you find 10, my nephew's there, Lot. Lord, please, for if there's any righteous man, God said, okay. What Lot didn't do is even when the angels came and said, let's run, remember? He tried to bargain and say, well, I want to go to this city. And they're going, run for the hills, pack it up and go. And he's like, well, maybe I should just go to this city, that city. And he said, and whatever you do, don't look back. When we move a campsite and God says, don't look back, you don't look back. Luke 10, 18 and 19. God has given us the power. First Jesus said, I've seen Satan fall like fire. And then he said, I've given you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions. Does that mean we're trampling on serpents and scorpions? Obviously not. I'm not one of those snake handlers. And to overcome the enemy, and nothing shall by any means harm you. Are you stuck in a spot and you're thinking, I can't get out? God's given you the authority and the power and the might. Last verse, Matthew 16, and this is really important, 13 to 16. Now when Jesus came into the district of Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, and others Elijah, but still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, you are Christ, the Son of the living God. You will not be able to pick up your tent unless you decide who you believe God is. I believe he's Christ, the Son of the living God. And I decided that I'm going to follow Jesus. If he says no camping, I'm not camping there. It's who you decide that you are going to trust and believe in. You have the power and the authority to trample all evil. Are you using that power and authority? I'm going to. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. And when Jesus says, move your campsite, this is what I'm doing. And I'm moving. Thanks. Julie's going to close in a song.